This is me when I was in college. You can't tell, but I'm on a ship here, studying phytoplankton, the world's most important life forms. After this, I made some videos to help identify phytoplankton species that can create harmful algal blooms, and then I continued to make science videos, which led me here. And now this episode takes me full circle back into the world of phytoplankton.
I haven't seen one of these for a long time. But this is the harmful algal bloom sampling, right?
Yes. I'm with Melissa Carter, a biological oceanographer with Scripps Institution of Oceanography, and we're meeting up with artist Judit Hersko to sample the water from Scripps Historic Pier.
Researchers started sampling on Scripps Pier back in 1916, and some of the earliest measurements that were collected were temperature and salinity.
We're also sampling for harmful algal blooms as part of their monitoring program. It's just like old times for me, except today, I'm joining a long line of women who have sampled the Pacific Ocean from this very pier.
The first woman to walk the pier was Easter Ellen Cupp. Finally, she ended up writing the quintessential book about the diatoms of the West Coast.
Judit has a special interest in Easter Ellen Cupp, the first woman to get a PhD in oceanography from Scripps. So we were both very excited to sample the pier in her footsteps.
The seas are rough today, but the color is amazing.
First, we logged the color of the water, which can tell scientists what's in the water, like the amount and type of phytoplankton and how much sediment is floating around that day. We lowered a bucket down to sample the water, recorded the temperature on a custom-engineered thermometer, and then filled some containers to bring back to the lab for analysis.
Get your sciencey Popeye arm going.
Next, we did our net tow to scoop up phytoplankton to look at under the microscope.
So let's see what our catch is here. It's pretty clear water.
Even though it looked fairly clear, the microscope told a different story.
And there are these beautiful ornate structures that then inside of those have chlorophyll and other pigments in them potentially to help them use the sun to create energy.
Using the sun to create energy is called photosynthesis. And just like plants on land, phytoplankton take in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and release oxygen in the process. And because oceans make up most of the Earth, phytoplankton are critical to all life on Earth, including you and me. But if these microscopic plants are part of a vast unseen ocean, how do we get the word out about them?
I think art is a great way to share the science, a great medium to do that in because they are so beautiful.
And that's exactly what Judit is doing in her PST art exhibition, Mosaic Ocean.
It's almost like Alice in Wonderland looking into the wall here.
Judit's exhibition uses 3D stereoscope technology from the 19th century combined with modern video and images recorded by the Jaffe Imaging Lab at UC San Diego. Judit is an artist whose focus for this exhibit was to put nature on display as the art itself.
With this work, I feel like what I want people to take away is the beauty of that nature that they cannot see with the naked eye and realize how important they are. I want people to experience that through the wonder.
While it's true that phytoplankton affect all of us on a broader scale, the harmful algal blooms that I studied in the Pacific Northwest had a huge impact on commercial fisheries, such as crab fisheries, filter feeding fish, and shellfish growers. It also has a huge impact on local indigenous communities that rely on harvesting shellfish as a food resource. And I noticed while I was filming this episode of Becoming Artsy that all of UCSD, including Scripps and the aquarium, were built on indigenous lands, specifically Kumeyaay lands. So when I saw this traditional Kumeyaay boat in the wider exhibition, I followed my curiosity to a workshop hosted by Stan Rodriguez, president of Kumeyaay Community College and educator for the wider community.
The word for tule in the Kumeyaay language is asuk. Say that, asuk.
Asuk.
The word for tule boat is ha-kwaiyo.
Ha-kwaiyo.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the name of the exhibition, yeah?
Ha-kwaiyo.
Oh.
Stan uses his boat building workshops as an opportunity to pass on the Kumeyaay language. Since the Kumeyaay were displaced from the coasts, words pertaining to the ocean are especially at risk of being lost.
What's the Kumeyaay word for ocean?
Ha-sil-wik. Ha-sil-wik. What that means is a western salt water.
After some final touches on the tule boats, they were ready to go to sea.
We're going to launch some boats.
So safety first. And we even learned more Kumeyaay words with the start of our race.
When I say Kiem, that means boat.
Kiem.
Chapak, Hamar, Hawab, Ashan, Tarot, Kiem.
Okay, and not to brag, but
we have the first place medal.
After the boat launch, we went back to set up camp. That evening, Stan spoke to us more about the history of the Kumeyaay people and the importance of the language.
Culture and language, spirituality, they all support each other. And if you take one away, it makes it difficult for the rest to stand up. The term, the new world, it's not new to us. How can you discover a land where people are already residing? So what we do, we bring our past. We're reviving it with who we are today. You know, we have endured a Holocaust and we are still here. So when we sing our songs, that is resistance. When you dance our dances, that is resistance. When we speak our language, that is resistance. And we do that out of love.
That conversation with Stan made me think a lot about what we consider to be unseen. The literal unseen of the ocean might inspire future oceanographers to learn about the oceans and walk the pier, but the unseen history of an entire people connected to the ocean, that's really important too. Because our world's not just about art and science, it's also about the people we share it with and how we share it with one another. Thank you so much for watching Becoming Artsy. Please like, subscribe, and leave a comment about your thoughts on the intersection of art and science and your experience with the unseen.